Irreconcilable differences. Our legal system uses those two words to sum up all of the different issues that can leave relationships in ruins. Irreconcilable differences. And often when there are irreconcilable differences, a person ends up with an ex. You know what I'm talking about, an ex-wife, ex-husband, ex-girlfriend, ex-boyfriend, ex-boss, ex-employee, or how about this one? Ex-best friend forever, you know, BFF. Ex-BFF. I don't know how you can be an ex-best friend forever, but some people are. And it's a bitter breakup if it is. An ex is kind of a good name for what it is, because it's like the person is saying, I'd like to just ex that person completely out of my life. It reminds me of that old country song, All My Exes Live in Texas. And Texas is a place I dearly love to be, but all my exes live in Texas, and that's why I hang my hat in Tennessee. And so irreconcilable differences are not just found in the context of marriage. Everywhere we look, we see relationship wreckage, fractured families, aunts, uncles, brothers, sisters, parents, and children who can't seem to get along, in-laws that act like outlaws, and disgruntled employees, and noisy neighbors, and nasty neighbors who fight over the fence. And when it comes to irreconcilable differences, the list can be very, very long. I think of these, the Yankees and the Red Sox. There's one. That one's kind of a shout out to Pastor Pedro, who's on the Red Sox side of that fight. You see the bank balance and our bills. There's an irreconcilable difference sometimes. You say those two never seem to match up. How about PC versus Mac? You know, I'm a PC, I'm a Mac, all of those commercials and all that. Hannity and Combs, they're real active these days. You know, you see those things. Donald Trump and Rosie O'Donnell. You know, there's a match made in, well, somewhere else than heaven. How about this one, the last one I thought of? Kimbo Slice and Pee Wee Herman. If you don't know who either of those guys are, you're probably all right. But irreconcilable differences. And God's Word tells us that when there are areas of life that seem hopeless, that seem helpless, beyond hope, that Jesus is actually able to build a bridge at that point, that God can fill the gap in our lives, and God can reconcile even irreconcilable differences. And no matter how broken something may look, we need to remember that God has the ultimate set of tools, and He can fix it. And that's why I titled tonight's teaching in Ephesians 3, Reconcilable Differences. Reconcilable Differences, because as we'll see in Ephesians 3, it builds on that same theme that we saw from last chapter. Quick review of Ephesians 2 for us is that God turns trash into treasure. And our lives without God, it's kind of like there's a long trail of trash left behind as we walk through life. And that's the spiritual fallout of our life before we knew the Lord. And so it should be no surprise, you know, when we have a trash life that we lead that trail of trash and just a lot of relationship ruins and seemingly irreconcilable differences because we have an irreconcilable difference with God. And because of all that wreckage, that relationship wreckage there, we need reconciliation. That's the eternal purpose of God in one word, reconciliation. If you want to know the dictionary definition of reconcile, it's this: to reestablish friendship, to bring into agreement, to make compatible, to bring into harmony, or to restore a relationship. It's like the words of that old famous song, He can build a bridge over troubled waters. And so we find the very reason that Jesus Christ came, to reconcile irreconcilable differences. And in our natural state, we are irreconcilably different than God. We have a problem with Him, and because of that, so often we have problems with everyone else. And this is the solution to that problem, that in Christ we can be reconciled to God. And in Christ we can then be reconciled with one another. And the result of that reconciliation is the church, the body of Christ. Reconciliation is actually the main message of the passage that we study here tonight, Ephesians chapter 3. And Paul breaks it into basically two halves here in this chapter. The first is Paul's point, and that will take us for the first 13 verses. And then you see after that Paul's prayer, verses 14 through the end of the chapter. And so first, just looking at this, Paul's point, His point is basically this. It boils down to this. If God can reconcile Jews and Gentiles into one body called the church, then God can reconcile anyone, anywhere through Christ. That at the end of the day, if you could bring together these differences, these irreconcilable differences in Christ, then he can do it for anyone. And so let's look at Ephesians chapter 3, verse 1, in all its glory and detail. And it says, "For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus for you Gentiles." And let's stop right there at the end of verse 1. It forms the foundation of the next 12 verses, as I said, and it's Paul's main point. He's saying here, "I am a prisoner of Christ for you Gentiles." Now, why is this important? It's important because you see that Ephesians, the letter to the Ephesians, it is a prison letter. And Paul is in prison for a very specific reason. And the reason was, he put it right there, for Jesus and for the Gentiles. Paul was a Jew who put his life on the line, and it actually ended him in prison. And the reason was that he was preaching a very simple message, which was this: God loves the Gentiles, and they can be reconciled to God through Jesus Christ, as can the Jews. And that message, maybe we've heard it enough in our life that the answer is found in Christ, that we don't even find it that surprising. But that message in that day certainly stirred up a lot of troubled waters for Paul. If ever there was a loaded word in the first century, it was the word Gentile. Those were fighting words, irreconcilable differences between the Jew and Gentile. If you jot this down and look at it later, Acts chapter 22, verse 22, Acts 22:22, Paul was preaching the gospel, and it's just this simple. He was saying, God has in Jesus Christ reconciled all people, not just some, but all people to himself, whether Jew or Gentile, they can come to God through Jesus Christ. And the moment that Paul used the word Gentile, when he got to that part of the message, and he said Gentile, the crowd of Jews went wild, and they rioted, and Paul got arrested. Now, to give you some of his history, I think it's really important to see it, that Paul was not born Paul the Apostle. He was not originally the apostle to the Gentile world. In fact, he was originally named Saul. He was a very Jewish man, and such a dramatic change occurred in his life that God even changed his name. And before Saul or Paul became a follower of Jesus Christ, he was a Pharisee. Now, the Pharisees weren't fair, you see, because they were hyper-conservative, kind of self-righteous, legalistic people. Paul was a very religious man, and this is important to know. He was self-righteous, and like most other of the Pharisees there, he despised Gentiles, couldn't stand them, hated them. In fact, as a Pharisee, Paul would cross the street anytime there was a Gentile there just to make sure that he didn't share air or have some Gentile dust end up on him. And so as much as Paul hated Gentiles, Paul hated Christians even more. He persecuted them, as we see in the scripture. He hunted them down and tried to put them in prison himself. Now, why did Paul hate Christianity and Christians so much? Well, the reason is that Christians, the church, they were a group of people who were reconciled to God and reconciled to each other. And the Christian church, in fact, was made up of Jews and Gentiles who united under the common bond of their relationship with Jesus. And Paul could not stand that. He believed Jews and Gentiles were meant to be irreconcilably different, and that was just the way it was supposed to be. And not only that, but this is especially important, Paul did not believe that he himself needed the cross of Christ to be reconciled to God. After all, he was a religious man. He was a moral man. He was a Pharisee. He was a Jew, a good man. Why would he need Jesus' help? And so here's a great lesson from Paul's early life, which is that you can be a religious person, a very zealous person, and still not be reconciled with God, still not be right with God. Religion doesn't make you right with God. In fact, it can actually make you wrong with God and wrong about God. And only Jesus can reconcile a person, the irreconcilable differences, first of all, between God and man, and between man and other men and women. So Paul here starts out with some irreconcilable differences in his life, with Gentiles, with Christians, and even with Christ. And Paul was on his way to persecute Christians in Acts chapter 9 when the resurrected Jesus meets him right there in the middle of the road and says, "Hey, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" It was like Jesus was asking Paul, "Why are you my enemy? Why do you think we have irreconcilable differences? Why do you hate the very people I love? Why are you trying to kill people that I died to bring life to?" And so Jesus takes that persecution of Christians very, very seriously, because the Bible says that we are like his bride. And if you really want to get me upset, certainly a persecution of my wife might be even more upsetting to me than trying to hurt me directly. And so Paul here, he was hurting the bride of Christ when he was hurting Christians. And so Paul had religion, but he did not have a real relationship with God through Jesus Christ. And so he needed to be reconciled to God. And so what happened on the road to Damascus in Paul's life was that he became a believer in Jesus that day. He was reconciled to God through Jesus Christ. And this is so important. At that point, God gave Paul the ministry of reconciliation. You might say, the ministry of reconciliation, what is that? Well, you need to know, if you're a Christian here, you have it, so you need to know what it is. The ministry of reconciliation, its details are found in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 18 through 19. I'll read it with you. This is what it says, 2 Corinthians 5, 18 through 19. "Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ." That's the only way it happens. And he says, "and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation." That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not just a certain set of people, not imputing their trespasses to them. In other words, he's not counting their sins against them, but he's committed this word of reconciliation to who? To us. And so the ministry of reconciliation is something that every Christian has. It wasn't just for Paul. And it's this, it's announcing the news that God wants to reconcile. In fact, that he's already taken every step to get back together, showing and telling others that God wants to be friends, to work things out. You know, that he says, "Hey, I don't want to be enemies with you. If there's a problem, if there's a lack of peace between God and a person, it's not because God doesn't want to work it out." And so the Bible says that we're the ones with the problem. You know, that we are sinners, and a lot of people have a problem with that. But that's what it's saying. It's saying, hey, if you don't agree with God, guess what? He's not the one who's wrong. You know, and a lot of times in relationship counsel, you'll try to discern, well, you know, this person's pointing at that person or whatever. But if you come in and you sit down and God's in one seat and you're in the other, and you point over and say, he's the problem, well, I know right away that is not it. You know, that's not true. The ministry of reconciliation, God wants to reconcile, and he has built that bridge. How did he do it? He did it through sending his son for our sin. That's what he did. He showed his seriousness. He showed how serious he was about wanting to do it by saying, I will build that bridge with my very body. And so Paul's changed life was perfect proof of the fact that God can reconcile irreconcilable differences. Paul was once a Gentile hater. He was once a Christian hater. And now he's a prisoner of Christ Jesus on behalf of the Gentiles. If you don't find a little humor in that, well, I know God has a sense of humor in doing something like that with Paul and with us. So you see in verse 2, it says, "If indeed you've heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given to me for you, how that by revelation he made known to me the mystery." As I've briefly written already, he's talking about his other letters and the portions of those things, "by which you can read and you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known to the sons of men, but it's now been revealed by the Spirit to his holy apostles and prophets." Now, what Paul is talking about there, twice in this little section and elsewhere in the chapter, he uses the word mystery. Now, I don't know if you like mysteries, you know, mystery movies or whatever, but he's not talking there in that sense. It's not Agatha Christie, it's not Sherlock Holmes or whatever. Anytime the word mystery is used in the New Testament, it's actually talking about some thing, some spiritual truth that was not revealed until Jesus came, that it could not have been understood fully except in the light of the revelation of Jesus Christ. As he came, you go, oh, now I see what God was doing. And so that's what he's talking about when he says, verse 5, it's been revealed. It's now been revealed. It's a solved mystery. The secret is out. And Paul is proclaiming it, and that's his ministry of reconciliation. What was the mystery? Well, just to make it really clear, it was questions that seemed impossible to answer. How will God reconcile irreconcilable differences? I mean, you've got a holy God and you've got unholy people. You know, you've got all these Jews and you've got all these Gentiles, and God chose this group of people, but what about everyone else? And all these types of things. Well, what's going on here? How's God going to get sinners to love God? How's God going to get sinners to love each other? That's an even deeper question. The mystery is solved there in Jesus. That's what he's saying here. The mystery has been solved, my friends, and here it is, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs, verse 6, of the same body, and the partakers of his promise in Christ through the gospel, of which I became a minister according to the gift of grace of God that was given to me by the effective working of his power. Now, I pause there to remind you the main message of this passage, because Paul's writings are dense, man. There's a lot that you can just sit here and pore over and think on. But this is the big picture, again, as we come through it, that Jesus came to reconcile irreconcilable differences. And he is saying to the Gentiles, hey, you guys are partakers of all the promises that God has given. And so Paul's point, if Jesus could reconcile Jews and Gentiles in this thing called the church, then he could reconcile anyone, anywhere. There's nobody who could say, oh, sorry, God couldn't fix this one. This one is way beyond that, because certainly Paul looked like he was way beyond help, way beyond hope. You also see that Paul thought that Gentiles were way beyond hope and help, and they all got help from Jesus. And so the animosity between Jew and Gentile in Paul's day could not be overstated. And again, that may be way out there and kind of theoretically, but you know, maybe there's people in your life right now that you say, man, the animosity between me and this person could not be overstated. I mean, anything that you could say, you are still falling short of how much we just can't stand each other or can't get it worked out, or how bad things have gotten. And you see them with generational hatred. In other words, for little kids, they teach them, if you ever see a Gentile, you just get away from them. They're really bad people, every last one of them, you know, that kind of thing. And they grew up thinking this way. Deep division, passionate prejudices, things they felt very, very strongly about. Irreconcilable differences, it would seem. And you still see these things today, of course. Much of the tension in the world is centered around what people perceive as these kind of irreconcilable differences. Imagine for a moment if you were hired by the U.S. government to be the ambassador in charge of Middle East peace. You know, you think your job's hard right now, whatever you're doing, you know, you say, man, I had a tough day at work. Well, what if you were that person? You know, okay, here's your new assignment. You're going to go over there and you're going to get them to all work it out. You know, the Israelis, the Palestinians, anyone else you can find over there, just make sure that they're all good friends, that they're buddies, that they're reconciled to each other, that they just go out to lunch and laugh and have a great time. They drop their differences and all that, you know. How would you do it? Could you do it? Would you say, oh, yeah, I think I could get that done in a day, no problem? Well, I used to have a really cynical non-Christian coworker. These are his words, not mine, so don't hold it against me. But his Middle East peace plan was this. He used to just say, just nuke it and pave it. Nuke it and pave it. That's what he would say. Bomb the whole area and just cover it over, make it a parking lot. That'll be real peaceful. What was he saying? Well, from a human perspective, there is no solution. It's hopeless, it's impossible, it's irreconcilable. It's always been this way, it'll always be this way. And a lot of times, again, people would say that about maybe some human relationship they have. Just nuke it and pave it. There is. It's always been this way, it's always gonna be this way, there's nothing else I can do. But what's impossible with man is possible with God. And what is irreconcilable with mankind is certainly reconcilable with God. And I think of it this way. We've seen it firsthand. There is one of the ministries that we support here as a church. It's called For Zion's Sake. And it is the Calvary Chapel that is actually in Jerusalem. And it's just one of many ministries that have experienced this. But in the church there, in that Calvary Chapel there, you actually have Israelis and Palestinians who have come to Christ as adults even, and they worship side by side. They in the same place, in fellowship, in friendship, in Christ. Now, again, how does it happen? Well, simply that Jesus Christ, when a person comes to faith in him, he gives a common purpose that is greater than any difference than someone might have. And what could be greater than the hate, generational hate of mankind? Well, there's only one thing I know, which is the love of God that is much greater than all. And so coming into true contact with Christ, it changed Paul, and it has changed countless millions of lives ever since. It's what took him from being a Gentile-hating, self-righteous Christian killer. That's what he was. To be a humble servant of all who was willing even to suffer and even eventually die for the very ones he had once hated. And so if God can do it for him, we have no excuse. And so you see verse 8, it says, to me, I'm less than the least of all the saints. This grace was given that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. This is really what I think Bible teaching is all about right here, the unsearchable riches of Christ. That's why we're not going to run out of material anytime soon. Why? Because we teach the Bible. We teach Jesus Christ. We never have to say, well, I wonder if there's anything new to talk about. Listen, the unsearchable riches of Christ. Paul says, if you want to talk about Paul, well, I'm less than the least. You really are going to run out of things pretty soon with me. And he had a genuine humility, I think, that came from seeing his own sinfulness, his own condition, his own poverty spiritually, when he finally came into contact with. And he said, man, but the unsearchable riches of Christ. Now that's something I could talk about forever. And so you see him talking about it here, verse 8, grace being given. Grace implies that a person can't earn it, deserve it, or be worth it. And so Paul had lived his whole life thinking he was worthy, or at least trying to be that, and thinking everyone else was the one with the problem. And so he finally realized, man, we all got the problem. Jew, Gentile, and everything in between. And he says, as a result, Paul no longer thought of himself as too good for anything or anybody. And so when God's call came to Paul, and it was, Paul, Jew of Jews, former Pharisee, here's what I want you to do. Go preach to the Gentiles. Oh, you mean my former enemies? The ones who, many of them maybe harbor grudges even against me because of things that I did to their families during that time? Yeah, those are the ones. I want to preach a message of reconciliation through you. Now, you know, maybe Paul wrestled with it, but his ultimate answer, God, that would be a privilege. That's what you see him doing, and he goes out and does it. Now, when you have an awareness of your own sin, when you have an awareness of your own shortcoming, it's amazing how much you can give grace to other people. I've found that many people are fault finders, you know, this fault finders, you know, sin sniffers. But it's amazing when you come into a situation where you realize, woo, I found the problem. I am the problem. Then you can become a grace giver. And it's one of the greatest signs that a person really has embraced the grace of God when they begin to be a grace giver rather than a fault finder. And so you see that happening in Paul's life. God saves him, he forgives him, and because of that, he also begins to be a person who seeks to save and forgive others through that message of reconciliation. It takes a humility. That's what it's really all about. Reconciliation always does. The humility to say, I was wrong. And so you see verse 9 that he says, to make all see what the fellowship of the mystery, there it is again, which from the beginning of the ages had been hidden in God who created all things through Jesus Christ, to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in the heavenly places, according to the eternal purpose which he accomplished in Jesus Christ our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence and faith in him. Now, verse 9, he uses that word again, mystery, and I just want to remind you what that means. It's just something that up until Jesus came, people couldn't figure this one out. But now, as it's been revealed through the life of Jesus, through the scriptures, as we're able to read them here, it says, God has made it clear to anyone who wants to see it that this is what he was doing, that he's going to reconcile sinners to God through Christ, that he's going to reconcile sinners to each other through Christ. That's such a powerful thing. It's so simple, but it's very, very profound, my friends, which is that when we are reconciled to God, it's amazing how things begin to reconcile side to side, too. Now, that doesn't mean you're going to get along with everyone, because everyone didn't get along with Paul, right? I mean, there were people who then, the minute Paul became reconciled to God, well, then they wanted to wreck his life. But you see that he was a person who was the one who was seeking the reconciliation always. The Bible says, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with all people. What does that mean? There's a part that doesn't depend on you. So you can't feel anything other than, well, Lord, I've done what I could do, as long as you do that. And so you see here the result being the church. The result of the reconciliation with God and others, that's the church. If you ever want to know what is church supposed to be about, reconciling people to God, reconciling people to each other. That's what church is all about. Very, very simple. Not a building, not a place. It's a people that God is working in. That's all it means. The church, it literally means the called out ones. Called out from what? The wreckage. That's what it is. Called out from all that relationship wreckage. Called out from being estranged from God. Called out from being at enmity with everybody else. Reconciled to God, reconciled to each other. And of course, as Pedro even talked about it in the previous teachings, you know, it's not an organization, the church. Oh yeah, the church, it's the building, right? No, it is the body. It is a living, breathing organism. It's just simply people who God is working in their lives. All believers everywhere with lots of unreconcilable differences. I love the way Revelation 7:9, if you jot this one down, you know, sometimes people say that the gospel is very narrow. You know, it's so narrow. Well, it is a narrow path. It only goes through Jesus. But here's what's amazing. As you look at Revelation 7:9, it describes heaven this way. A great multitude which no one could number of all nations, tribes, peoples, and tongues. Now, to me, that sounds pretty diverse. It sounds like some irreconcilable differences to me. But what do they have in common? This is what it says. Standing before the throne and the Lamb, that's Jesus, clothed with white robes. In other words, forgiven because of their faith in Jesus Christ. People from all over the place. God is able to reconcile irreconcilable differences. And believe me, heaven will be very diverse. Now, we're living in an age where people have, I think, very little idea what the church is supposed to be, and also very little appreciation for how important the church is to God and how important the church is to the world. You know, again, the word that's used for the church is the bride of Christ, and I can't think of anybody who's more important to me in my life than my bride. I mean, you think about that, that's the, you know, that is the ultimate relationship there on a human level. And so that's what God uses as the relationship. And he says, man, I care a lot about the church. And again, Pastor Pedro said something so beautiful the other day. This is what he said. I wrote it down in my notes, that the world cannot afford for the church to lose sight of its message or mission. Wow. Why not? Because we have a ministry of reconciliation. In fact, we have the only one. We have the remedy for the deadly disease that the entire world has. And there is no plan B. You know, it's not like, it's, oh, well, okay, we'll do it something different. No, the gospel is the answer. It's the only answer, and we have that message that God is in Christ reconciling the world to himself. And if the church loses sight of that and just gets busy fighting itself, you know, can't seem to get along even with each other, well, then how in the world are we ever going to reconcile the world to God and the world to each other? And so the church is meant to be a place where God proves his power to reconcile irreconcilable differences, even a place where people learn to love each other even through some of the difficulties, even when it's hard, especially when it's hard and challenging. You know, Christians ought to be known for that. It's especially easy to get along with yourself. I don't know if you have experienced this, but you know, if you find that you have irreconcilable differences with yourself, you know, you probably need to see a doctor or something, you know. But Jesus places us in the church for one reason at least, which is to find some people with some irreconcilable differences, some people who might be a little sandpapery in our life, to find out if, hey, can you rub up against people without rubbing them the wrong way all the time? And oftentimes, you know, churches are filled with people who know very, very little about reconciliation to God and very little, even less, about reconciliation with others, about getting along with their brothers and sisters. And so I think of this, a little story I heard. It was a man who was rescued after many years on a deserted island. He'd been there all by himself. You know, he was the only survivor from the shipwreck. And the rescuers found him, and they found him with three huts there. And they asked him, hey, why three huts? You know, it's just you, right? And he said, yeah, that's my house over there, the first hut. And then he pointed to the second hut, and he said, well, that's my church. And they said, well, what's the third one? He said, oh, that's the church I used to go to. I don't like that place anymore. Now, don't misunderstand me. There's nothing wrong with God, you know, taking a sheep from one pasture to another, or moving a person from one part of the body to the other. I'm not talking about that. But so many Christians, again, they just seem to float above it. You know, church hopping, you know, is a thing that so many people do. You know, just the endless search for the perfect church and all that. And And the minute somebody, I don't get along with that person. The best thing to do, I'll just go find another place, you know. But this is it. The reality of our spirituality is lived out in community. That's where we really find out about it. That's when we really find about what happens when we bump up against differences or difficulties or some struggles or maybe some words that you say, man, you know, those were kind of hurtful. We're going to have to work that through. See, the Bible says this, that Jesus is supposed to be made known by the church and in the church. How do we do that? Well, this is what the Bible says, that all men would know you by your love for one another. See, and if we can't be reconciled with one another, then how is the world going to look on and say, man, that's working. It's working for them. Maybe it would work for me. And so many say, man, I love God. It's just God's people I can't seem to get along with. You know, I love humanity. It's people I can't stand, you know, but it really can't be that way. That's like saying, man, I love Scott and Lynn, but I just can't stand their kids. Well, sometimes we can't stand our kids, but that's okay. You know, we all work those things out together. And where do we find the resources to reconcile? You know, you might be saying, hey, I've tried, you know, I'm trying, or it's hard, or the other person won't, and all these things. Where do we find the resources to heal hurts, to actually cover over, as the Bible says, a multitude of sins, not acting like they don't exist, but actually to heal them, to forgive, to work through these things? Well, it all, I believe, hinges on really the second part, as you'll see, which is knowing and experiencing the love of God. If you'll return with me to Ephesians 3:12, if you just look at it there, you're going to see four amazing words found there. Your translation may use four different words, but they're the same basic idea. It's this: boldness, verse 12, access, confidence through faith. Now, thinking about those words, those are all words that say, man, we are reconciled to God. We are friends with God. We got boldness. It's not like we're scared going, oh, no, maybe he's mad at me. Listen, God is not mad at you. He's madly in love with you in Christ. That's what it says. We are friends. We're reconciled. Jesus paid the price for my sin. It is not separating me from God any longer. I can approach God boldly to the throne of grace for help in times of need. And I don't know any time of need that I have more than when I need to reconcile some wreckage. When I say, man, something's got to be made right here. And he says, confidence through faith in Christ. The practical result of my reconciliation with God, it's that because God has given me grace, I can give other people grace. Because I'm forgiven, I can be forgiving. And again, many would say, Pastor Scott, it's just not that easy. You're right, it's not that easy. In fact, it's impossible. But again, with God, all things are possible, even the impossible, especially the impossible. Jesus can help us reconcile irreconcilable differences. I've used the example before, but it's so powerful in my own life, I need to hear it again, and so do you, which is Corrie Ten Boom. She was a Holocaust survivor. She was a Christian. She helped hide Jews during that time. Her story is told in a book and movie called The Hiding Place. And after the war ended, she was released from that prison, and she went around the world with a ministry of reconciliation, just preaching the gospel everywhere she went about God, how God had helped her through this deep, dark pit and this horrible experience in her life, and how he could do the same in others. So she is there preaching God's grace everywhere she goes, speaking to large and small groups alike. But one night after Corrie had spoken to a very large crowd, there was one man who waited until most of the people were gone, and he came up to her, and she said that she froze when she saw his face. He was one of the former guards from the concentration camp. And this man had been especially brutal. He had been a monster, as she put it, and the very person who had directly contributed to the death of her family and many of her friends. And so she tells how his face was just like so horribly familiar and yet somehow different as she saw him. And some years had passed, and this former Nazi told her, Corrie, I heard you were here, and so I struggled with it, but I had to come and hear you speak, and I came to tell you that I have come to Christ. I am a Christian now, and I came to ask you if you would please, or if you could, forgive me. And Corrie said everything in her screamed no. You know, inside she had this incredible war, like that all of a sudden everything slowed down so much. And she said, Lord, no, not him. You can't ask me to do this, not after everything that he has done. No, Lord, I cannot. And she said that very quietly in that moment, God told her, yes, you're right. You cannot, but I can through you. And so she stood there, she said, for what seemed like an eternity, and she finally reached out and touched his hand, realizing that this was the very heart of the gospel that she was preaching, that if she was going to preach it, she was going to be asked to practice it. And God here was reconciling sinners first to himself and then to each other, reconciling what was completely irreconcilable. And Corey said it was by the strength of God's grace that she even got her hand out there and embraced this man that had once been her most bitterest of enemies, and they wept together for a long time. And she said, that day, with God's help, I forgave him and have continued to do so since that time. And she said, at that point, she went free from a second prison, which was the prison of bitterness and hostility. Now, it's hard for us to imagine, of course, a greater gulf than between a Nazi prison guard and a former prisoner. But if God can reconcile that big difference, then he can certainly reconcile the smaller ones. And the reality is, every relationship I know has irreconcilable differences. My wife and I will go to the grave with irreconcilable differences, and praise the Lord for them. We're having a great time working them out. 19 years this year, you know. She'll come around, I'm sure, at some point. But in Christ, we have the greatest thing in common. That's what it's supposed to be. And so the other differences don't have to divide us, because Christ unites us. You know, and you may say, well, that seems so simple, but it is. And one of the things I love about CCK here, Calvary Chapel Kendall, is there's so many different people. There's such a diversity in this church body. We can't say, well, people will ask us, what's the demographic of your church? And say, everything? Everything and everyone. You know, and the thing is, what do we have in common? Christ. And that's enough, or at least it should be. And it's funny, the world can unite around some things for a time anyway. I remember this, it was kind of funny. Back in college, San Antonio, Texas. And I let a friend talk me into going into a Metallica concert. Now, I was pretty much of a heavy metal fan, but that was even more. So I wasn't a Christian at the time. So just, you know, don't be a fault finder. You see, I was going to this Metallica concert, and thrash metal. I mean, this stuff is just pretty raunchy. And so I'm not recommending it here for anybody. And it was a total dive. I mean, the place where they were playing, this was before they were even really, really popular. But the place that they were playing, it had no seats at all. It was a room about maybe almost this size, but just no seats, just a big pit, you know. And my friend said, man, it's going to be a mosh pit. It's going to be incredible. You're going to love it. And we got there, and there were, well, I would just say scary people. I don't mean to be judgmental, but they were violent. I mean, they were crazy, even before anything. I mean, drunk and drugged, you know, just crazy. People who had tattoos on their tattoos. I mean, I'm not, nothing against tattoos, but I mean, these guys just, wow, you know, wow, that's a lot. And at some point in the concert, this will give you an idea of the kind of thing that was going on there, is that somebody jumped up and stole the microphone during the concert. I mean, stole it right in front of the singer, you know, and the guy's like, kill that guy, you know. And they never caught me. No, that's a joke. But I asked my friend before I agreed to go, what if I bump into somebody? I mean, what if I elbow somebody accidentally? I'm not going to be in there, you know, trying to get anybody, but what if I do? Won't someone kill me? And this is what he said. If you do, if you bump into someone, if you knock them down or whatever, just look them in the face and yell, Metallica, you know? And he said, you do that, you'll be fine. And I did. All night, I'd knock somebody, knocked me into Metallica, and yeah, you know, everybody's friends, you know? Ah, the fellowship of all that. And so here's why I think about that. Man, if Metallica can unite a bunch of drunk, drugged, hardcore heathens, can't Jesus somehow unite a bunch of Christians? If we have Jesus in common, can't that be enough? Can it be enough for our families? Can it be enough for our marriages, our relationship, our friendships? Can it be enough? I think it can. And you see in verse 13, he says, therefore I ask that you do not lose heart at my tribulation for you, which is for your glory. So that's the end of the section there for the first part of the chapter. And Paul's point, again, just to review it, look, if God could take a guy like Paul, who once hated Christ, Christians, and Gentiles, and make him a servant of all three, then he can certainly turn around anybody's life. There's nobody who has an excuse for why God can't help them. And then the second section of the chapter, it's Paul's prayer. And incidentally, if you want to pray effective prayers, you know, and who doesn't? You know, who wants to,
I want to pray ineffective prayers, so don't work.
No, if you want to pray and pray effectively, I think the great idea, one great idea is simply to mark and pray the prayers that are found in the Bible. Why? Because God's will is in His Word, and it says that He'll answer prayers that are in accordance with His will. And so, Paul's prayer, hey, he answered it with Paul, you know, I'll plagiarize it. That's okay, I'll use that one, and if you want to practice on someone, practice on me. Pray this prayer for me and for everyone that you love, and even those who maybe don't know that you love them and think that you hate them or, you know, can't seem to work things out. Paul's prayer, it's awesome. If you want to know how to reconcile irreconcilable differences, so much of it is found right here. With God, with others, this is it. Verse 14 to 22, the resource, the power of a connection with Christ, the power of God's love flowing in your own life and out into other people. For this reason, Paul says, for this reason, what reason? The reconciliation he'd experienced, the ministry that God had given him of helping other people see it, Paul breaks out in this prayer. For this reason, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, verse 14, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now, that's quite a prayer right there. But he opens it up. Let's pick it apart just a little. He opens up the prayer with an important thought. He says, our. See that in verse 14? Our Lord Jesus Christ. And I love the word our. You know, because a lot of times when you talk with people who are, you know, irreconcilable, it's my and yours. Well, my, this is my, and I'm going to take my and our, you know, and you never hear my kid, this, your kid, this, you know, you never hear our. This is our problem. This is our family, and we're going to do something about our problem with God's help. So often when people use those pronouns, they're pointing at somebody else. Well, again, he's saying here, our. Our family. You Gentiles are my family, my friends. We need to be friends. We used to be enemies, I know that. But you know what? Not anymore. Why? Because we're part of the same family. And he says, verse 16, a prayer for inner strength by the Spirit of God. That's how these things, it takes a lot of strength to forgive. It doesn't take much strength to be a vengeful, hateful person. That zaps your strength, but you don't need to be a strong person to do that. I think a person who exhibits great strength is a person who has the self-control to forgive through the power of God. And anyone who has that external pressure in their life, you know, nothing brings pressure upon your life like irreconcilable differences. If you right now have, you know, friction in your family or in your workplace or whatever else, it can weigh on you so heavily. So much pressure with that sort of thing. You know, and you see these things where health or financial things or relationship or all of those things, you know, pressure, putting pressure on you. And Paul says, inner strength, that's what we really need. Think about a breakable object, which our heart is certainly a breakable object, our life is, like a vase or something. What happens if the outer pressure is greater than the inner strength? Well, it crushes it, right? It destroys that thing. There's a collapse. And you see that happen in people's lives all the time. But what is it when the inner strength exceeds the outer pressure? When whatever pressure is brought upon that thing, there's still an inner strength there. Well, it stands strong. And that's Paul's prayer, that they would be able to do that. That the Gentiles in Ephesus would be able to do that. Why? Because of the power that is inherently within them? No. Verse 17, that Christ may dwell in your heart through faith. He's the one who's going to be giving you that inner strength. And dwell is a very important word in that passage, verse 17. It means to be at home, at peace, to be a place where, you know, putting up their feet on the lazy boy. I don't know if you've ever been to a person's house where you really didn't feel like you were very much at home. Like they didn't want you to dwell there. I mean, they were hoping you were just kind of passing through, you know, kind of formal, keep you at the door, you know, keep you outside. You know, it's raining and they're talking to you from inside the house and you're getting the message, hey, I'm not really welcome here, I don't think, you know. But this is the word that's just exactly the opposite. It's throwing wide the door and saying, Lord, dwell in my heart. This place is your place. Mi casa es su casa. Here's the fridge, help yourself, you know, whatever. Every room of the house is open to you. And that's true fellowship and friendship and relationship. And Paul's prayer, you think about it here, that God would be right at home in your heart through faith. And then you see verse 17, he talks about being rooted and grounded in God's love. I love that because you see with a tree, a root. What does a root do? It gives it strength against the storm. It's something that actually keeps it. Deep, wide roots, a stable tree, a solid tree. And verse 18, boy, you could think on this for a long time. He says, with all the saints, I want you guys to do this together and talk about it and point it out to each other, the width, the length, the depth, the height of God's love. The width, it's that God so loved the world, you know. Yes, it's a narrow path. It's through Jesus Christ. There's no other name by which we must be saved. But it's wide. God so loved the world. Jew and Gentile, black and white, everything in between. Male, female, young, old. There is no demographic that God says, oh, well, that one I'm not interested in. You see the length. God's love, it never started. It never going to end. He's not going to say, oh, well, I'll love you now, but, you know. Things don't work out, you know, I may look around for somebody else or whatever. No, the length of God's love. You see the depth of it. What depths would he go to? Well, he dropped out of heaven, came down here to be born in a manger, a feed trough. That's pretty low. Crucified on a cross, beaten, spat upon, mocked, dead and buried. That's how low he was willing to go to demonstrate his love for you. And then the height. Well, Ephesians says it several times, raised to the right hand of the Father in heaven, higher ground, that God says, there's the depth of my love. Not that I would just give you a better life here on earth, but man, I got something eternal for you that will go on forever and ever and ever, and you're not going to even be able to understand it fully right now. And so Paul is praying just that, that we would know the unknowable. I like his wording. He says that we would know the love of Christ. That is beyond knowledge. You go, well, Paul, how could I do that? Well, the same way that God can reconcile unreconciled differences, he can also give you knowledge of the unknowable. Experience things that you can't even put into words and intellect. And he says that you might be filled to the fullness of God. This is a big word here, filled to the fullness of God. Fulfilled. Isn't that what everyone really wants in life, to be fulfilled? But the way to be is to be filled full of God. This is what's really going to fill a person. Most other things people try to fill themselves with only empty them further. So what does this mean? Well, I like to think of it pictorially. If you go to the ocean and you take a bucket and you submerge that bucket, it's going to be filled with all the fullness of the ocean, but it couldn't possibly contain all the fullness of the ocean. You couldn't get a big enough bucket to do it. But the bigger the bucket you get, the more of the ocean you're going to get in it. And God just says, man, I want to enlarge your vision, your life, your heart, your mind, everything about you to just be full of the fullness of God and continual in ever-expanding capacity. And that's what verse 8 called the unsearchable riches of Christ. He says, man, there isn't an end to this stuff. And Paul's prayer, just summarizing it out, it's inner strength, a life of love, that we would be filled with all the fullness of God in ever-increasing capacity. And I believe if a person is experiencing that, there's going to be a lot of reconciliation in their life and not much wreckage. And as a pastor, part of my role here, I do a lot of relationship counseling. I love doing it, but there's a part of it I don't like doing. And it is seeing and sensing and having that awareness that there is so much relationship wreckage. You know, sometimes stuff that came before Christ, but sometimes even after coming to Christ. And I think so much of it is looking for love in all the wrong places. Looking for love. And too many faces, you know, empty expectations, people looking over at whoever and saying, man, fulfill me, please fulfill me. You're not fulfilling me. But people were never meant to fulfill us. We're meant to be filled with the fullness of God. And when we're filled with the fullness of God, then we're not going to be looking to other empty people saying, why aren't you doing what I need you to do? With such hostility, with such resentment so often, with such pain. And Paul's prayer that we would be so full of God's love, that it would spill out on everyone around us, even if they don't accept it, even if they don't understand it, even if they don't embrace it the same way we have, that we would find ourselves leaving a trail of reconciliation, not a trail of wreckage. That's what we ought to be known for as Christians. And that's not to put anybody on a guilt trip. It's to make sure that everyone's on a grace trip to say, man, I want that, Lord. I need that. That is the direction I want to go, not the way of the world, but the way of God's word. And you might be asking yourself, man, could God answer such a prayer in my life? Oh, I don't think he could, you know, not me. I've got too much wreckage. You don't understand. Nobody has ever loved me like that. I don't even know what that means. It's too much to ask. And that's why I think Paul puts at the end of that prayer, verse 20, but to him who's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be the glory in the church by Jesus Christ to all generations forever and ever. Amen. Now, I love that phrase. You can go chew on that one if you like. Exceedingly abundantly above all we ask or think. I mean, that is a bunch of big stuff there. And can you ask or think a lot? Well, I can. I can ask all kinds of things. I can think all kinds of stuff. And one of the things I would ask, again, in God's will, you know, he's not just going to give you everything you could ask or think. I think yellow Lamborghini, you know, and $1 gas to put in it, you know, or something like, no. He's talking about, you know, what would be in alignment with his will. What is it? Well, can you with me ask and think that this church might be and continue to be, as it is being, a place where irreconcilable differences are reconciled, where families come to be fixed, where marriages are mended, where friendships are formed that go beyond the superficial and beyond the first fight or the first difference or the first whatever, where people who have been enemies of God maybe their whole life and never known what it is to have the love and forgiveness and mercy of God, and to have people show that to them, that they would be reconciled to God and to each other. And as we look at this, man, I think there's a subtlety that we could miss in here, and many people do miss it, you know. I want to make sure no one misses it tonight. In verse 21, it says, to him be the glory in the church. To him be the glory in the church. It's talking about Jesus there. And there's a repeated idea all throughout Ephesus, which is the place and plan of the church, that, you know, God has a reason for the church, and the church is a good thing. It says it in verse 6, it calls it the same body. In verse 10, it says by the church. In verse 15, it says the whole family, you know, the faith family he's talking about there. Verse 18, he says with all the saints. So all the way through, different words being used for the idea of the church. And you know, certainly Ephesians says a lot about the church, but this is the subtlety. The church is God's idea. It's a great idea. It's important. It's crucial. It's a place of grace and mercy and love. It should be. It can be. The church, it's a place where God creates a group of people who would be known for their love, that the world would look on and want what we have for each other, reconciling irreconcilable differences, first to God, then to each other. But this is so important. No church can save you. No church can save you. The church, a church, any church, cannot reconcile you to God. All the things that a church can be and can do, there's one thing it cannot do, which it cannot save you. It, just like Paul, really couldn't save anybody. He was just a mouthpiece. He was just a messenger. And I'm really excited that so many came to church tonight, that so many come to church week after week. But coming to church doesn't make you a Christian. It's really important to see that. You know what? Coming to Christ makes you a Christian. And forgiveness of sin isn't found or given by a place, you know, that by an institution. It can't be done. It's found in a person. It's found in a person, Jesus Christ. He is the reconciler. He's the bridge builder. He is the one who laid down his life so that we might have it. And sin always separates. It always leads to death. And for me to be reconciled to God, someone had to die. And that someone was Jesus. He died for my sin, to deal with the sin problem. And it wasn't until I came to Christ. I had come to church many, many times in my life, but it wasn't until I came to Christ that I was reconciled with God, and I began to be reconciled with my family and so many of the relationships that had been a wreckage in my life up until that point. It wasn't coming to church that saved me. It was coming to Christ. And for me to be reconciled to God, not only do I need to come to Christ, but you know, there's that dying to self. There's that dying to sin that is going to actually reconcile me to other people. Because, you know, for reconciliation to occur, I say it again, someone has to die. I have to die to my pride. I have to die to my prejudice. I have to die to my right to be right and to say, well, but. You know, and I close with this question. Have you been reconciled to God personally? Not have you come to church, but have you come to Christ? It's not me pleading. It's God pleading through me. That's how it says it in 2 Corinthians 5. Listen to this. It says, now then, We are ambassadors for Christ, Paul's saying, as though God was pleading through us. We beg you, we implore you, he's saying, on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So if you've ever wondered or you've ever looked at your life and say, man, why so much wreckage? Why so much wreckage in all my relationships? Why can't I seem to get along? Why can't anybody get along with me? What is the problem here? Why does the world have so many problems? Why so many irreconcilable differences? Well, it comes down to that simple statement. Sin separates. It separates us from God, and it separates us from each other. And when we're separated from God, there's no way we're going to be able to get along with anybody else. God's the easiest one on the planet to get along with. So if you can't get along with God, you're going to have a lot of problems with all the people around you. And the only way I've ever found to get along with people is to get right with God. We're sinful by nature, and he is sinless by nature. That's an irreconcilable difference. He's perfect, and we're not. That's an irreconcilable difference. And our sin separated us from God, and the wages of sin were death. And God is life, and we were death. That's an irreconcilable difference. But God reconciled that irreconcilable difference. What does the word reconcile mean? It means to bring into agreement. And that's what he did. He took a hold of sinful man. He took a hold of sinless God. And God, the Son, brought those two together. He built the bridge in himself. And so Romans 5:10, it says, while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son. How much more now, having been reconciled, are we going to be saved by his life? And so that verse right there, it presents both the problem and the solution. We were enemies of God. We were dead in our sin apart from Christ. Whether we were a moral man like Paul, who had his belief system and everything else, very passionate about it, or just a plain out pagan, you know, it doesn't really matter. That person still needs to be reconciled to God. That's the problem. We're all sinners. And if we can't get along with God, we'll never get along with anyone else. And so that is what you see there, the problems that we see in our lives. But then the solution's also found, that same verse, because it says, while we were enemies, God sent his Son to do this transaction that he said, okay, your sin, I'm going to put it on my Son. The righteousness of my Son, I'm going to put it on you. And I now am reconciled to you as if you were my beloved son, my beloved daughter. What an amazing transaction that is, but only God can do it. And only Jesus is the answer to that. And so tonight, what I'm going to ask worship team to do is just come up, and we're going to close out with a song. But first, we're going to close out with an opportunity. If there's anyone here tonight who knows that they need what we've talked about here tonight, you need to be reconciled with God. You need to get right with God. You want to do that. And you say, but how? I don't know how to do that. Well, God has made it simple. He says, I would want to dwell in your heart through faith. He's saying, what do? You open the door. How does somebody get into your house? You invite them in through the door. How does Jesus get into your life? You just simply open up your life to him. And just like this prayer here, such a powerful prayer in the will of God. There's a prayer that you can pray that just says, Lord, I want you. I accept you. I need you in my life. And if you want that tonight, to be reconciled to God and then have the power through God to be reconciled with the people around you, to stop leaving a trail of wreckage in your life, to have a ministry of reconciliation, if that's your need here tonight, we're just going to close out in a prayer. And at the end of that prayer, I'm going to give you an opportunity to raise your hand and acknowledge your need and accept Christ here tonight as your Lord, as your Savior. So let's bow our heads, let's close our eyes, and let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for the lengths and the depths and the widths and the height of your love, that you would stretch out your arms on the cross there and say, anybody and all who would come, I would accept them, I will reconcile with them. And Lord, the only thing left is for us to reconcile with you, to come to you, and to ask for you to forgive us. Thank you for making it so accessible to all. And Lord, now I just ask that you would move among anyone here tonight who does not yet have that assurance of a relationship with you, that you would give them the courage, the boldness, the power, the faith to believe in you and to commit their life to you at this time. And so with our eyes closed, our heads bowed, if there's anyone here in this room who says, you know what, that's what I need. I need a relationship with Jesus. I wanted to start here tonight. I've come to church before, but man, I don't know that I've ever come to Christ. I want to come to Christ. I want to make it real. I want to make it solid and sure here tonight. If that's you, wherever you are, right in your seat, all you need to do is raise your hand to acknowledge your need. I see you there in the middle. You over here, God bless you. Anyone over to the left-hand side, I see you there, here in the front. Anyone else? He loves you. There's no reason to reject that love. It's the greatest love and friendship you'll ever find in any person. Anyone else here tonight? For those of you who raised your hand, I'm just going to lead you in this prayer. Repeat it after me. It's your words from your heart, and the power is in Jesus Christ to forgive. Lord, I thank you for sending your Son to die for my sin. I put my faith in Jesus here tonight as my Lord, as my Savior, as the best friend I'll ever have. I want to reconcile with you, Jesus. And I pray that you would give me the power to reconcile and to have a ministry of reconciliation among my family, my friends, and the world. Forgive me of my sin. Wash me clean. I want to follow you this day and forever. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you.